however be.
Okay, I'll be right back.
Good evening, everybody. I think we're on the air. Is that correct? I think we are. Good. Nice to see everybody here today. And for those of you who don't know, by the way, today is Red Flannel Day. So if you could... oh, yeah, you're kind of... Oh, well. So, yeah, it's adorable. So, hey, it is... So it's good to see everybody. We're going to have a good night. And Jonathan's going to lead us in worship, and then we'll dig back into Colossians chapter 4. So if you're able to, why don't you stand with me? I'll pray, and we'll have a wonderful, wonderful night together. Jesus, thanks for bringing us here to your house. And God, I ask you that you would touch every life and heart that is that's here and joining us online. And now, Lord, I pray that you would lead us by your Holy Spirit to draw closer to you. Jesus will thank you. We'll give you the praise and the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name. And we all said amen. Amen.
There's no God like Jehovah.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. As the trumpets call, lift your voice. It's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion still salvation. Oh, behold, he comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. As the trumpets call, lift your voice. It's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion still salvation down before in greater measure. You will do again, 'cause there's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can't move. All things are possible, and there's no broken body you can't raise, so that you can stay. All things are possible. Darkest nights, yes, you can light it up. Yes, you can light it up. Won't God ever revive my hope? Let hope arise, and death is overcome. You rose to victory, now you're seated forever on the throne. So why should my heart fear what you defeated? I will trust in you. No broken body you can raise, no soul that you can save. All things are possible. The darkest nights, yes, you can light it up. Yes, you can light it up. Oh, God, of a revival, let hope arise. And you've already won. Oh, God of the revival. Oh, God of the revival. Come awaken, you people. Come awaken your city. Oh, God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh, God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. The darkest nights, yes, you can light it up. Yes, you can light it up. Oh, God of a revival, open eyes. Death is overcome, and you've already won. Oh, God of a revival, the darkest night. Yes, you can light it up. Yes, you can light it up. Oh, God of a revival, and hope around when death is overcome, and you've already won. Oh, God of a revival, 'cause there's no prison wall you can't break through. No mountain you can move. All things are possible. And there's no broken body you can raise. No soul that you can save. All things are possible. Sing it with all your heart and believe it. There's no prison wall you can't break through. No mountain you can move. All things are possible. And there's no broken body you can raise. No soul that you can save. All things are possible. Love of God. your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all. You have been so, so kind to me. Don't overwhelm me, never ending, endless love of God. And oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the night. Good enough, I don't deserve it. Still, you gave yourself away. Don't overwhelm me, never ending, reckless love of God. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up. No wall you won't. Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. The name. Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The graves of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. And death. Death could not hold you. The veil torn before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. No death could not, and death could not hold you. The veil torn before you, the silence the pulse of sin and grief. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again, and you have no rival, and you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Now let's give praise to that name that is above all other names, the powerful name of Jesus. Lord, we worship you today. It's at your name, Lord, that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord. God, we praise you that your name is a strong tower that we can run to and find safety, Lord. It's your name that is above all others, Jesus. And so, Lord, we praise your name. We worship your name. Hallelujah. It's that name, Lord God, that we're going to rely on in just a few moments as we pray to you. We're going to ask the Lord today to meet every need that's here and those that are watching us. I know we have a number of people that can't be with us tonight that need a touch from God in one way, shape, or form. And some are watching. We're just asking the Lord to do what his word says that he'll do. And we know that he heals, and we know that he restores, and we know that he provides, and we're going to ask him to do all of that and even more. And if you need a touch from Jesus today, I'm just going to encourage you just to reach out to the Lord right now and say, God, this is what I need from you, and please, would you do that? I trust in your name. Those of you who are watching online, I want you to do the same as I pray. And we're going to ask God together that he will move by his mighty name in your situation, in every situation here. So would you pray with me? Jesus, we ask you right now that you would touch every person. And we ask you in your name that you would heal. God, we ask you that you would provide. We ask you, Jesus, that your Holy Spirit would restore what the enemy has tried to ruin and destroy and infect and hurt. God, so we speak healing and restoration and protection on all those situations, Lord God. Lord, touch those that are in need of a touch from you, whether that be physically or emotionally, Lord God, or mentally, Lord. I pray for every relationship that needs to be restored in your name. God, I'm asking you that you would just be the glory and the lifter of our heads today, that we would know that you have a plan for us, Lord, plans to prosper us and not to harm us. And so we call upon you, Lord God, and we seek you with our whole hearts today. So Jesus, across this room, we pray for your touch, and we pray, Lord God, for you to do what only you can do. God, to those that are online watching us now, I pray that your spirit would touch them as well. And God, that you would reach down to where they might be. And Lord, that they would sense your presence in the room that they are at, Lord. And God, all together, we'll thank you for what you do. And we'll give you praise for what you do, Lord, because you're worthy of it. You're worthy of it. We'll praise the mighty name of Jesus, that name that is above all other names. So it's in that name that we pray, and that we trust you, and we believe. And it's in Jesus' precious name we ask all of this. And the Lord's people said, amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for how good you are. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Well, why don't you welcome one another here today and let someone know today that you're glad that they're here, and encourage one another today. All right, welcome everybody. That's better. And Jonathan, thank you for leading us in worship today. And we appreciate that a lot. And we're in the book of Colossians still. We're on the last chapter. Everybody have notes that needs them or wants them? Because there is a little bit of a stack of notes left on the table if you need to get some. And we have been taking a long look at this small book in the Bible of Colossians, and specifically, we are in chapter 4, verses 2 through 6. We're talking on what we call the subject is when opportunity knocks, and we're talking about sharing our faith and what that looks like and how we kind of live that out, and what are God's expectations of us as we try to share the gospel with other people. What should we keep in mind? And this passage of scripture really gives us some really good insights as to what we should expect and how we should kind of conduct ourselves when we're trying to be a witness for Jesus Christ. Obviously, the very first act of witnessing that I would say that any believer can and should have would be that of water baptism. And it is when we proclaim outwardly what Jesus has done in our lives inwardly. And that's actually probably one of the very first acts of witnessing that a believer can do. And I'm thrilled that so far we have 4, maybe 5 people that are being baptized this Sunday morning. And those of you who would like to be baptized in water, Or those of you who are online, if you're local or if you want to fly in from out of state to be baptized, we'll take you. It's happened before. Hello, Amy. And if that's the case, let me know, and we will make sure that you're included in that. So this Sunday will be great. But what happens beyond baptism? What are we supposed to keep in mind as we try to share our testimony and share our faith? And let me just say that I've been around the church long enough to have seen a lot of scripted presentations on how a person should share their faith. And I think the heart behind all that is very, very good. Don't get me wrong. But I will tell you that there is nothing more powerful than a person's personal testimony. There are few things more powerful than that. And showing what Jesus has done in you or for you, that is powerful. And I want you to keep that in mind, especially those who might be hearing a study on this, on sharing your faith, and you think, well, I don't know how to do it. You know what? I think we make it too difficult sometimes. Just tell people what God's done in you. You're not called to have all the answers. You're not Josh McDowell. You're not the guy that wrote Case for Christ, Lee Strobel. You're not him. You just be you and share your faith and share your testimony. That can make an enormous difference. But let me read a few scriptures that were on here in this unit, and I'm going to try to finish this whole set of notes here tonight, because next week is our prayer meeting, and I'd like to finish this before we go into that. So take a look at the screen, if you will, verses 2 through 6. Says, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Now, we're going to pick up our study on page 7 in your notes. So if you want to jump there, we're talking about using wisdom in our witnessing, and how we need to be wise to some things. And we left off on this part in verses 5 and 6, and it's right in the middle of page 7. We must be wise in our surroundings. We must be wise in our surroundings. Last week, we uncovered how we should be wise in our speech. We should be wise with what we say. For example, I don't know if you're going to win too many people to Christ by walking up to somebody and say, you're wrong, I'm right. You probably need to be a little bit more seasoned with salt that way, right? But we should also be aware of our surroundings and where we're sharing our faith and what circumstances we're sharing our faith. Again, look at verse 5 and 6 again. I know we just read it, but look at this. Be wise in the way that you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Let me show you this highlighted quote here in the middle of the page 7. Paul counseled the Colossians to act wisely and to live with wisdom in their interaction with, quote, outsiders, with unbelievers. This is so important. So important. Number 2, I underlined this, that we should have a discernment within our own culture and within our own context, and the culture and the context of the person who you're trying to share your faith with. I think it's There's a lot of wisdom to understanding. In public speaker mode, it's good to know your audience. Okay? Okay? Now, this goes for one-on-one conversations too. But as a funny joke, well, it's not a joke. It's actually a true story. But I was speaking at a youth something in West Virginia. West Virginia. Mountains, everything, okay? And I drew attention to the fact that there are tornado drills in the schools in Ohio. And I said, you know, how you put your hands over your head, blah, blah, and they looked at me like I had a hole in my head. And it dawned on me, they don't get a lot of tornadoes in the mountains in West Virginia. That was a terrible illustration for me to spring upon them. You got to know your crowd. You got to know the people whom you're speaking to. How I might address a group of teenagers or college students may be quite different how I would address a senior citizens group. And this now goes with our one-on-one conversations as well. There are cultural things to consider. There are constants. The Word of God doesn't change, right? But our methods might change, and how we communicate might change depending on the context. How I might speak the Word of God on a Sunday morning, it might be a little bit different Saturday during the giveaway, depending on, and even then, depending on that crowd, okay? If I see I got a bunch of people with attitude, that might come off a little different than the ones that just say amen when I, you know, walk in the door. You got to kind of be led by the Holy Spirit that way. And so when you're having conversations with people, I think this is really important that you understand the culture that they're from, the context that they're from. Are they from poverty? Are they really wealthy? Are they very angry? Are they very happy? Are they this or that? It's a lot of the stuff factors in how you present the gospel. This is how we use wisdom when we do that. Look at letter B underneath number 2. An informed understanding of our surroundings is even more vital. Culturally, I will even say that geographically, it could be very different when you're sharing your faith with people. There may be a huge receptivity to a culture that is very open to the gospel. They're around it all the time. And then there could be, let's say you go to the northeast of our nation, which tends to, it's basically Europe. And there's not a lot of people open to the gospel. It's going to change how you share your faith. That's nothing that we need to be afraid of. That's nothing that we need to let intimidate us. We just need to be led more by His Holy Spirit that way. I underlined a phrase on the very bottom of page 7. I didn't underline it in yours, but I underlined it in my notes. We should infuse our speech with the message of grace. We should always be gracious. Paul told this church we should always be gracious. I'll say it later, I'm sure, but you're not going to win someone to the faith by having an argument. You're not. Especially if you don't have a relationship with that person. Goodness. If you're just going to somebody cold calling them, you don't even know them, and you're just throwing out how they're going to hell, that may not go well in some cultures. So you got to be led. I'm not saying that doctrine is wrong. What I'm saying is that how you present the gospel, that's the key. That is the key. Read the book of Acts sometime, and you'll see how Paul adjusted his message depending on where he was. When he saw the really smart people, he was a really smart guy. And so he knew how to interact with them. When he was in the jail in the prison, where he is now when he's writing this, he's interacting with the soldiers and the other prisoners, probably a different demographic than the Bereans, for example, and Paul was still successful in sharing his faith. So let's know our culture and our surroundings. Go ahead and go to page 8. There's a phrase that Paul uses saying that our speech should be seasoned with salt. I love salt. And what does salt do? It enhances, it brings flavor to food that might be a little dull. Salt also penetrates ice, for example. So it's very penetrating as well, and it adds flavor. I think that as personal as we make our presentation of Jesus and our testimony, that seasons the whole gospel presentation with salt. You don't have to have a lot of polish, okay? You don't have to be unshy. There are people that I have seen, I'll tell you a quick story. Some of you have heard it before. My first youth group in Athens, I had this girl. She might be watching. And she was just a soul-winning machine. Soul-winning machine, this girl. And one day she comes up to me and she gives me this big old list of people's names. There are 57 names on there. I said, LaWanda, honey, what is this? She said, these are the people who I have witnessed to so far this year. I said, you share the gospel with 57 people? She said, yeah. 6 said no. 6 said no. And then I look again, and there are administrative staff of the high school's names on there. The principal's name was on there. She's praying the sinner's prayer with the principal in his office. That was crazy. Now, if you knew LaWanda, I'm telling you, the quietest thing you have ever seen. So quiet. So just this little, weighs about 80, nothing, and just the quietest, shyest little thing, but wow, what a powerhouse. So believe me when I tell you, you don't have to have the polish of a mega church pastor in order to be an effective witness. All you got to do is be willing. All you got to do is be willing. Amen? Look at letter A underneath number 3 on the same page, page 8. It says, unique backgrounds and experiences along with individual perspectives and beliefs require the use of wisdom as we engage various people in different places along their spiritual journey. Now, how many of you know there's a lot of different backgrounds and philosophies and perspectives right now in our culture? And so it flies in the face of our faith. We have I shouldn't share this story yet. But we have a boy in elementary school in our church who has faced some pressure and persecution, 9 years old, because of his faith in Christ. I mean, it's not just reserved for the high school and the college campus. Okay? And so there will be a plethora of different beliefs out there now. I mean, how many genders are there now? 666, I think. See what I did there? Okay. And just a lot of different philosophies and a lot of different ideas that just fly in the face of Scripture. And we need to take that in consideration. And we need to be, in fact, I circled on letter B how Jesus Christ embodied in John chapter 1 verse 14, he is identified as being full of grace and truth. Grace and truth. Our presentation of the gospel should also be full of grace and truth. And sometimes we're heavy on one and light on the other. Sometimes we're heavy on grace, and we're so heavy on grace that we'll kind of water down the truth just because we want to be nice. Then other times we are so into the truth that there's no grace at all. You're burning in hell. Tell Judas I said hi. You know, and so those are two extremes. And Jesus embodied the perfect balance of grace and truth. Let me remind you, by the way, that Jesus' harshest words and actions were towards the religious leaders, not the sinners. His harshest words were against the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the leaders. I'm not telling you to find religious leaders and chew them out. What I'm saying is that there was a heart of grace that Christ had towards those who were lost in sin. And he was able to present the truth. And the truth set people free. And that's why I think we can see as well. Look at number four. In the midst of a culture that is volatile and hostile, the gospel of grace should be reinforced through the kind and compassionate tone in which we communicate. Don't fall for the bait of getting in a shouting match about your faith. Don't fall for it. And can I also say, if the cameras are rolling, if you're someplace and the news is out there, okay, don't be that guy. I'm just going to get on TV and I'm going to tell them whatever I think. It's like, oh, please. Use wisdom. Compassion still wins. I believe it's the book of Romans that tells us that it's the kindness of the Lord that leads to repentance. I'll repeat that. The kindness of the Lord leads to repentance. So, I'm not going to get in a shouting match. Somebody might even call me a name. Somebody might even insult my intelligence. Whatever. With all the keyboard muscle that they can muster, by the way. Don't. Because Jonathan's right, by the way. A lot of this now, social media. Oh. It's wonderful. I'm all over it, okay? But sometimes it is just so toxic, especially when I see Christians misbehaving. And for some reason, we have convinced ourselves that it's okay. It's okay to act less than Christ-like online. I better move on, okay? Oh, gosh, but I'm looking at my next points. Okay, we'll get to it later. Here we go. So let's give you some points of application as far as this whole study goes, okay? How do we apply all this to our witness and to our lives? Again, let's read verses 5 and 6. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Oh, that's so good. Make the most of every opportunity. It's another good one. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. So what are some things that we could take away from these verses that we've read here in Colossians 4? First of all, it's at the bottom of page 8. We cannot be argumentative. Can't argue. Because I promise, if there's people with a different worldview than yours, okay, they need Jesus. Did you know that you don't have to win every argument? Yeah. That just sets some. See? He says no. But people with different worldviews, they are going to be equally devoted, if not more passionately devoted, to their own perspectives than we are. And so that should not shock us, that should not surprise us. And the media that we have right now plays right along with that now. I spoke to a man for the first time ever. He's actually an attorney. And he was talking about the whole transgender stuff. And he was like, I can't believe that they're going after our kids the way that they are. Why are they going after our kids? And his time was short. I had a long answer for him. But he just sees the passion in that false perspective. But trans people are not our enemy. Did you know that? A drag queen is not your enemy. Like any other person who doesn't know Jesus, they need Jesus. They need Jesus. Now, they may be very passionate about what they believe. And so we should avoid arguing, but grace, there's grace. But don't hold back on the truth either. You could be a gentle force to contend with when it comes to sharing the truth of what the gospel is. They don't have to see the veins pop out of your neck and your forehead. Right? Let's go to page 9. Are you getting anything out of this? Okay. Letter A, number 2 on page 9. The compassionate nature of the gospel will be compelling. Yet it requires us to maintain our relational courtesy. Become the person that you want them to become. And if you're a jerk, then guess what you're going to reproduce? But if we show compassion to people that disagree with us, see, I've got friends that are gay. And it's okay. Because I'm praying that they find Christ. And so I'm trying to show them what authentic, genuine Christianity means. They know I disagree with them. We joke about it on Facebook. It's hysterical. I know Phil's going to disagree with this, but he's my favorite conservative, so here we go. And it's like, how cool is that? Just a diehard, well, a person who disagrees with me sees me that way. I thought, that's what I want. I want them to know I love them, but I still believe everything that the Bible says. I hope you have non-Christian friends. I really do. Oh, touch not the unclean thing, Pastor. That's what the Bible says. Not in that case, no. What business does I have with the works of unrighteousness? I'm like, ugh. You know, I don't want to be with you now, let alone a non-Christian. No, I. Jesus was drawn to non-Christians, and interestingly enough, non-Christians were drawn to him. And there was no compromise whatsoever in Jesus' lifestyle or his message at all. What a great lesson for us. Let's go to the next one, the letter C. We must keep in mind that we can compel, but we ultimately cannot convince. Oh, man. Okay. All right. The role of a witness. If you've ever seen Law and Order, okay? If you've ever seen Law and Order, the role of the witness is to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God. Correct? All right. It's the DA's responsibility and the attorney's responsibility to convince the jury of what they heard, to pronounce either guilty or not guilty. You and I as witnesses, we tell the truth. The whole truth. And nothing but the truth. But it's not your responsibility to see somebody make a decision to get saved. That is the advocate's role. The Holy Spirit's role. Quit thinking that you have to do the Holy Spirit's job. Now, that doesn't mean that you do a poor job in compelling people about the gospel. I mean, be passionate about it. Tell the truth. Reminding yourself and them that eternity is at stake at times. But ultimately, the responsibility, that lies with Christ. That's through the work of the Holy Spirit. When I share a sermon on Sunday, and I will give that my best, not only the presentation of it, but the preparation of it as well. But ultimately, the one who's responsible for changing hearts in those green seats, that's him. It's not my role. And that should free you up. That should liberate you. Well, I witnessed, but they didn't get saved. Remember what I said 2 weeks ago? We have people that are the planters of the seed. Then there are people that are the waterers of the seed. And then there are people that are the harvesters of the final product. Each of those roles are equally important in sharing our faith in Christ. No, we don't keep track of seeds planted on our annual reports that we send to the Assemblies of God office. How many seeds did you plant? And so sometimes we are such a numbers, results-driven type of society, we almost assess failure if X amount of people didn't bend the knee as just as I am was playing. If you came by bus, they'll wait. And it's not, some of you don't understand that reference. That's a Billy Graham Crusade reference, and it was such a good joke, and you totally miss it. But anyway, so we think that that's where the action is, and actually, as we present our faith, the action starts with that first seed. That's when the work starts, by planting that seed. And there are so many ways to plant seeds. And don't belittle that role. It's vital. It's vital. I got to keep going. In the middle of page 9, our hope and our confidence must remain in the power of the gospel to ultimately convince others of its truth. You don't have that kind of power. I don't have that kind of power. And I've been doing this for 34 years. And I don't have that power to convince anybody of anything as far as the gospel goes. Oh, I might convince you that I'm funny. I might convince you, and even that's hard. Yeah, I might convince you that I'm an okay speaker, and that can be challenging. But as far as making life-changing, eternity-rocking, eternal decisions, life-changing decisions, you and I don't have that kind of power. That's next level stuff. That's the Holy Spirit. That's why we got to rely on the Holy Spirit to change lives. That's why when you come here, for example, on a Sunday morning, you're going to get the Word of God. Because I can't rely on anything else to see lives changed. I can't. But it's the Word that changes lives. It's the Word. Don't place upon yourself this misplaced expectation to be the next Billy Graham or D.L. Moody. You just be you. God will do the convincing. You just be faithful. You just be faithful. Number 4 on the same page, we can contend. First we said that we can compel, but we cannot convince. Here, we can contend, but we ultimately cannot convict. It's the Holy Spirit that convicts people of sin. Not my diatribes, not my Facebook posts. It's the Holy Spirit. He might use some of that stuff, but ultimately that responsibility is with the Holy Spirit. Let me also say this. Disagreement with somebody does not mean you hate them. Okay? Because that is a cop-out terminology that is used in our culture right now. Whatever phobic or hate speech, I don't hate anybody. I'm just telling you the truth of the Word of God, that's all. That's hateful. No, it's not. Don't let them call you that. Or if they call you that, don't accept it. Don't kind of hunker down saying, oh, I don't want to be hateful, so I can't share the truth. Bull. You cannot accept that. I hate that. In fact, you know what that, anybody watching me who thinks that my disagreeing with your lifestyle or your beliefs makes me hateful, you know what? You've lost the argument. You've lost your own debate because you've made it personal. And you can no longer argue your facts or you can no longer present your case because all you can do now is attack me personally. And you've totally lost. And that's debate 101, by the way, folks. If they can no longer talk about the facts and they want to make it personal, you've won. You've won. That was totally free. Let's go to page 10. How many do I have? 12. Okay, here we go. Okay. Top of page 10. Emphatic disagreements, a contentious spirit, or even a persuasive argument cannot ultimately produce spiritual conversion. So be careful what you post. Roman number 4 up there on page 10. Confrontation and condemnation do not lead people to repentance. So be careful what you post. Seriously. The keyboard, I mentioned keyboard muscle. The keyboard muscle that is exhibited by the body of Christ drives me crazy sometimes. Especially around election year. Here we go. Now we got people declaring for their candidacy and all this other stuff. And so now we're going to get ugly again. It drives me crazy. Some people are going to recommit their lives to Trump as their savior. And then there's others that are going to be for this person or that person and all that. And to be quite honest with you, I know God's in control. I'm not making a political statement here, so don't send me those emails. But here's what I'm going to tell you. We have not done well as the body of Christ in the last couple of elections, presidential elections. We can do better. Do you know how many, I'm going to share it. When Vice President Pence, whatever your feelings on this, when he was doing what he had to do on January 6th in the halls of Congress, I merely posted, I'm praying for Vice President Pence. The next day, I posted, I'm praying for our president, President Joe Biden. I wish you could have seen the anger from Christians. Some defriended me. Oh, no. Don't care. It's like the kid that runs away when they're in fourth grade. They're coming back home. Don't you worry about it. They'll be back. Anyway, but it got ugly. And I did not endorse. I didn't say who I voted for. I said, I am praying. You know how the Bible tells us we should do in Romans 13, by the way, and in 1 Timothy? I am praying, and I had the body of Christ wanting to hang me and try me for treason, if not out and out blasphemy, because I did it. And I thought, what is wrong with us? What is wrong with us? And you know who's watching? unbelievers. That's who's watching. All 2,000 plus of my friends watching that thread. And I was embarrassed by the actions of some Christians. Terrible. We can do better. So let's encourage us to be better this time around. Maybe God will actually give us what we want instead of what we deserve. Next, man, I got to keep going. We cannot be ashamed. Season with salt. We cannot be ashamed. By the way, you could pray. You could pray for somebody that you don't like. You could pray for someone you didn't vote for. Did you know that Jesus was neither a Republican nor a Democrat? How about that? Anyway, okay. We cannot be ashamed. All right. Don't hate me. All right. In our attempts to avoid being argumentative, we must not resort to the opposite extreme of avoiding gospel engagement altogether. Just because you've got some really angry sinners doesn't mean you should stop sharing the gospel. Maybe how you share the gospel can be adjusted depending on whom you're talking to. That doesn't mean you compromise the message. So don't let persecution keep you, or pushback keep you from sharing your faith. Don't let that stop you. In fact, I will even tell you that might be a sign that you're doing everything correctly. Just something to think about there. Underneath there, Scripture describes visible, tangible, and verbal expressions of the gospel that we as God's people must consider. Let me give you all three of those. First of all, the visible elements of sharing the gospel. The testimony of our lives must show the gospel. So if you're going to proclaim the message on Facebook, please live it outside of Facebook. If you're going to stand in here and worship God and tell us how awesome of a God you serve, then please act like that when the pizza guy comes. That was awesome. That was awesome. And I mean it. Absolutely. Our lives must bear a family resemblance to the holiness of our Heavenly Father. People should look at us and they should know we're Christians. Not because we're weird, but because we're like Him. Here's the tangible. The tangible is this. The testimony of our love must spread the gospel. The testimony of our lives, it must show and spread the gospel. Testimony of our love must spread that. In other words, we are known more. Let me put it this way: we are known more for what we are for than what we are against. And this is where the church has made a big mistake, because we often can tell the world what we're against, but we're not really good about telling people what we're about. And I think people need to know what we're about more than what we're against. Top of page 11, I'm sorry I'm flying through this. I want to get this done so bad. Our loving actions towards others are an expression of the gospel in an effort to display God's love that is made available to all people in Christ. I'm telling you, what we do every December is a huge example of that. But hopefully you don't limit that just to the second weekend in December. Our acts of love, that needs to be something that we do every day. Every day. Stan.
Love never fails.
Never. In fact, it covers a multitude of sins. So there's power in demonstrating God's love. So good. And then here's the verbal. We don't leave out the verbal. And at the very bottom of page 11, I told you I was flying through this. Apart from a clear explanation of the gospel, people may be inspired to lead more upstanding lives, but heart change can only occur as a response to the good news. That's where heart change takes place. Planting, watering, harvesting. Let's go to the final page, page 12. I'm going to let you go. Thanks for your patience with me. Very top of page 12, it says this: apart from a clear explanation of the gospel, people may be inspired to lead more upstanding lives, but heart change can only occur as a response to the good news of Jesus Christ. Then next there, if we remain silent, we simply are refusing to answer the door when opportunity knocks. So, somebody you work with is facing a very difficult time, the door's knocking. That's an opportunity. And I'm not saying break out your best sermon with all four points starting with R. What I'm saying is that this is a chance to tell the difference that Jesus Christ made in your life and share that with other people. I starred Roman number 5 in my notes because there's really four elements of every opportunity to witness listed right there. Number one, the truth about God. There's a distorted view of who God really is. Number two, our sinfulness and how we need redemption. A lot of people believe in God, but they don't believe that they've ever sinned. They don't believe they need God. So then when they know who God is and then they're confronted with their own sin, then number three, forgiveness comes through Jesus Christ. And then fourthly, that salvation that's received through faith by grace. And that's the gospel. God's real. I'm a mess. Jesus fixed that. And it's only through him that I can get everything right spiritually that I need to get right. That is a very raw presentation of the gospel. But it works. It works. Here's how I want to conclude things here. Some of you might remember when we started this unit, we talked about the importance of prayer when it came to sharing the gospel. Okay? And again, I've highlighted this in the second to last paragraph. We must pray for witnessing opportunities and trust the Lord to open doors to share the gospel and open up our hearts with a burden and a compassion for the lost. It all starts with prayer. I'm going to leave you with Matthew chapter 9. And a lot of us think, okay, I want to be a soul winner. So, I need to memorize the Romans Road. I need to recite the four spiritual laws. I need some chick tracks. You know, some of you don't know what those are. And you know what Jesus said? Jesus said, here's the first thing you need to do. It says, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. What's the next part? Now you go get them. That's not what he said. Ask the Lord, pray. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. When you drive by that campus, you pray. When you drive by that part of town where you see a lot of hurting people, start it off by praying. Pray. Pray that the Lord of the harvest will send workers. And you might be one. It might be somebody else. But pray that the Lord of the harvest will send laborers into that harvest field. Amen? Amen. So Jesus, I thank you for the amazing responsibility and opportunity to share a message of hope to the world. You've given us that. You've commissioned your disciples and us to do it. Now, Lord, I pray that we would live this out every day. God put people into our path in these next few days that we could plant a seed, that we could water a seed that someone else has planted, or maybe you may use us to harvest that. But God, we start with prayer. So we pray for harvesters and we pray for ourselves. God, keep us safe as we go home. And may everything that we do and say, Lord God, be for your glory. Bring us back here Sunday excited and ready to hear from you and to be used by you. And it's in Jesus' name, and we all said amen. God bless you. Thanks for being with us. We love you, and we will talk to you again soon. Bye-bye. All your emails. Jonathan plays soccer at Gmail.